Good wishes to all of you. Our part 2, chapter 10, 18th century political formations. Look at map 1, state formations in the 18th century. If you look at map 1 and 2 closely, you will see something significant happening in the subcontinent during the first half of the 18th century. Notice how the boundaries of the Mughal Empire were reshaped by the emergence of a number of independent. Map 2. British territories in the mid-18th century. See Chapter 4, Table 1, which group of people challenged Mughal authority for the longest time in Aurangzeb's reign. Emergence of a new number of independent kingdoms. By 1765, notice how another power the British had successfully grabbed major chunks of territory in eastern India. What these maps tell us is that political conditions in 18th century India changed quite dramatically and within a relatively short span of time. In this chapter, we will read about the emergence of new political groups in the subcontinent during the first half of the 18th century, roughly from 1707 when Aurangzeb died till the Third Battle of Panipat in 1761. The crisis of the empire and the later Mughals. In Chapter 4, you saw how the Mughal Empire reached the heights of its success and started facing a variety of crises towards the closing years of the 17th century. These were caused by a number of factors. Emperor Aurangzeb and depleted the military and financial resources of his empire by fighting a long war in the Deccan. Under his successors, the efficiency of the imperial administration broke down. It became increasingly difficult for the later Mughal emperors to keep a check on their powerful mansabdars, nobles appointed as governors. Subhadars often controlled the offices of revenue and military administration, Diwani and Fauzdari as well. This gave them extraordinary political, economic and military powers over vast regions of the Mughal Empire. As the governors consolidated their control over the provinces, the periodic remission of revenue to the capital declined. Peasants and Jamindari rebellions in many parts of northern and western India added to these problems. These revolts were sometimes scattered by the pressures of mounting taxes. At other times, there were attempts by powerful chieftains to consolidate their own positions. Mughal authority had been challenged by rebellious groups in the past as well, but these groups were now able to seize the economic resources of the region to consolidate their positions. The Mughal emperors after Aurangzeb were unable to arrest the gradual shifting of political and economic authority into the hands of provincial governors, local chieftains and other groups. Rich harvests and empty coffers. The following is a contemporary writer's account of the finance bankruptcy of the empire. The great lords are helpless and impoverished. Their peasants raise 2 crops a year, but their lords see nothing of either, and their agents on the spot are virtual prisoners in the peasant's hands, like a peasant kept in his credit house until he can pay his debit. So complete is the collapse of all order and administration that through the peasant reaps him harvest of gold. His lord does not see so much as a wisp of straw. How then can the lord keep the armed force he should? How can he pay the soldiers who should go before him when he goes out, or the horsemen who should ride behind him? In the midst of the economic and political crisis, the ruler of Iran, Nadir Shah Sekar, and plundered the city of Delhi in 1739 and took away immense amount of wealth. दिस इन्वेजन वॉज फॉलोड बाई ए सीरीज ऑफ प्लंडरिंग राइड्स बाई दी अफगान रूलर अहमद शाह अब्दली हू इन्वेडेड नॉर्थ इंडिया फाइव टाइम्स बिटवीन 1748 एंड 1761. नादिर शाह अटैक्स डेल्ही. द डिवेस्टेशन ऑफ डेल्ही आफ्टर नादिर शाह इन्वेजन वॉज डिस्क्राइब्ड बाई कॉन्टेम्पररी ऑब्जर्वर्स. वन डिस्क्राइब्ड द वेल्थ लूटेड फ्रॉम द मुगल ट्रेजरी एज फॉलोज. 60 lakh of rupees and some 1,000 gold coins, nearly 1 crore worth of gold ware, nearly 50 crores worth of jewels, most of them unrivaled in the world, and the above included the peacock throne. Another account described the invasion impact upon Delhi. Those who had been masters were now in dire straits, and those who had been revered couldn't even get water to quench their thirst. The recluse were pulled out of their corners. The wealthy were turned into beggars. Those who once set the style in clothes now went naked. And those who owned property were now homeless. The new city Shahjahanabad was turned into rubble. Nadir Shah then attacked the old quarters of the city and destroyed a whole world that existed there. Take a look at figure 1, a 1779 portrait of Nadir Shah. Already under severe pressure from all sides, the empire was further weakened by competition among its different groups of nobles. They were divided into two major groups or factions. The Iranians and Turans, nobles of Turkish descent, for a long time the later Mughal empires were puppets in the hands of either one or the other of these two powerful groups. The worst possible humiliation came when two Mughal empires, Farrukh Shah 1713 to 1719 and Alamgir II 1754 to 1759, were assassinated, and two others, Ahmad Shah 1748 to 54 and Shah Alam II 1759 to 1816, were blinded by their nobles. Take a look at figure 2, Farrukh Shah receiving a noble in court. Emergence of new states. With the decline in the authority of the Mughal empire, the governors of large provinces, the Subardar and the great Jamindars, consolidated their authority in different parts of the subcontinent. Through the 18th century, the Mughal Empire gradually fragmented into a number of independent region states. Broadly speaking, the states of the 18th century can be divided into three overlapping groups. States that were old Mughal provinces like Awadh, Bengal and Hyderabad. Although extremely powerful and quite independent, the rulers of these states did not break their formalities with the Mughal Empire. States that had enjoyed considerable independence under the Mughals as Watan Jagirs. These include several Rajput principalities. The last group included states under the control of Maratha, Sikhs and others like the Jats. They were of differing sides and had seized their independence from the Mughals after a long-drawn armed struggle. The old Mughal provinces. Among the states that were carved out of the old Mughal provinces in the 18th century, three stand out very prominently. These were Awadh, Bengal and Hyderabad. All three states were founded by members of the high Mughal nobility who had been governors of large provinces. Saadat Khan, Awadh, Murshid Kuli Khan, Bengal and Asaf Jah, Hyderabad. All three had occupied high mansabdari positions and enjoyed the trust and confidence of the emperors. Both Asaf Jah and Murshid Kula Khan held a jat rank of 7,000 each, while Saadat Khan's jat was 6,000. Hyderabad. Nizam-ul-Mulk Asaf Jah, the founder of Hyderabad state 1724 to 1748, was one of the most powerful members at the court of the Mughal Empire, Farrukh Siyar. He was entrusted first with the governorship of Awadh and later given charge of the Deccan. As the Mughal governor of the Deccan provinces during 1722, Asaf Jah had already gained control over its political and financial administration. Taking subsequent advantage of the turmoil in the Deccan and the competition amongst the court nobility, he gathered power in his hands and became the actual ruler of the region. Asaf Jah brought skilled soldiers and administrators from northern India who welcomed the new opportunities in the south. He appointed Mansabdars and granted Jagirs, although he was still a servant of the Mughal Emperor. He ruled quite independently without seeking any direction from Delhi or facing any interference. The Mughal Empire merely confirmed the decision already taken by the Nizam-ul-Mulk Asaf Jah. The state of Hyderabad was constantly engaged in a struggle against the Marathas to the west and with independent Telugu warrior chiefs, Naikas of the Plateau. The ambitions of the Nizam-ul-Mulk Asaf Jah to control the rich textile producing areas of the Coromandel coast in the east were checked by the British, British who were becoming increasingly powerful in that region. See map 2. The Nizam's army. A description of the Nizam of Hyderabad personal troopers in 1719. The Nizam has a sware Savari of 400 elephants, several thousand of horsemen near his person who receive upwards 100 rupees nominal pay and are extremely well mounted and richly caparisoned. In trying to consolidate their rule, why did Mughal Subdars also want to control the office of Diwan? Awadh. Burhan-ul-Mulk Sadat Khan was appointed Subdar of Awadh in 1722 and founded a state which was one of the most important to emerge out of the breakup of the Mughal Empire. Awadh was a prosperous region controlling the rich alluvial Ganga plain and the main trade route between North India and Bengal. Burhan-ul-Mulk also held the combined offices of Subadari, Diwani and Fauzdari. In other words, he was responsible for managing the political, financial and military affairs of the provinces of Awadh. Take a look at figure 3. Burhan-ul-Mulk Sadat Khan. Burhan-ul-Mulk tried to decrease Mughal influence in the Awadh region by reducing the number of office holders, Jagirdars appointed by the Mughals. He also reduced the size of Jagirs and appointed his own loyal servants to vacant positions. The accounts of Jagirdar were taken to prevalent cheating and the revenues of all districts were reassessed by officials appointed by the Nawab's court. He seized a number of Rajput Jamindars and the agriculturally fertile lands of the Afghans of Rohilkhand. The state depended on local bankers and Mahajans for loans. It sold the right to collect tax to the highest bidders. These revenue farmers, Ijaradars, agreed to pay the state a fixed sum of money. Local bankers guaranteed the payment of this contracted amount to the state. In turn, the revenue farmers were given considerable freedom in the assessment and collection of taxes. These developments allowed new social groups like money lenders and bankers to influence the management of the state's revenue system, something which had not occurred in the past. Bengal gradually broke away from Mughal control under Murshid Qul Khan, who was appointed as the Naib Deputy to the governor of the province. Although never a formal Subdar, Murshid Qul Khan very quickly seized all the power that went with that office. Like the rulers of Hyderabad and Awadh, he also commanded the revenue administration of the state. In an effort to reduce Mughal influence in Bengal, he transferred all Mughal jagirdars to Orissa and ordered a major reassessment of the revenues of Bengal. Revenue was collected in cash with great strictness from all jamindars. As a result, many jamindars had to borrow money from bankers and money lenders. Those unable to pay were forced to sell their lands to larger jamindars. Take a look at figure 4. Awadhi Khan Holding Court. The formation of a regional state in 18th century Bengal, therefore, led to considerable change amongst the jamindars. The close connection between the state and bankers, noticeable in Hyderabad and Awadh as well, was evident in Bengal under the rule of Aliwardi Khan, 1742-1756. During his reign, the banking house of Jagatset became extremely prosperous. If we take a bird's eye view, we can detect three common features amongst these states. First, tough many of the larger states were established by elsewhere Mughal nobilities. They were highly suspicious of some of the administrative system that they had inherited, in particular the Jagirdari system. Second, their method of tax collection differed. Rather than relying upon the officials of the state, all three regions contracted with revenue farmers for the collection of revenue, the practice of whom Izardari thoroughly disapproved of by the Mughals spread all over India in the 18th century. Their impact on the countryside differed considerably. The third common feature in all these regional states was their emerging relationship with the rich bankers and merchants. These people lent money to revenue farmers, received land as security, and collected taxes from these lands through their own agents. Throughout India, the richest merchants and bankers were gaining a stake in the new political order. Many Rajput rulers had accepted the suzerainty of the Mughals, but Mewar was the only Rajput state which defied Mughal authority. Rana Pratap ascended the throne at Mewar in 1572 with Udaipur and large part of Mewar under his control. A series of envoys were sent to the Rana to persuade him to accept Mughal suzerainty, but he stood his ground. The wanton jagirs of the Rajputs. Many Rajput kings, particularly those belonging to Amber and Jodhpur, had served under the Mughals with distinctions. In exchange, they were permitted to enjoy considerable autonomy in their wanton jagirs. In the 18th century, these rulers now attempted to attain their control over adjacent region. Ajit Singh, the ruler of Jodhpur, was also involved in the functional politics at the Mughal court. These influential Rajput families claimed the subadari of the rich provinces of Gujarat and Malwa. Raja Ajit Singh of Jodhpur held the governorship of Gujarat, and Savai Raja Jai Singh of Amber was governor of Malwa. These offices were renowned by Emperor Shah Jahan, Jahandar Shah, in 1713. They also tried to extend territories by seizing portions of imperial territories neighboring their wattans. Naghaur was conquered and annexed to the House of Jodhpur, while Amber seized large portions of Bundi. Savai Raj Jai Singh founded his new capital at Jaipur and was given the Subhadari of Agra in 1722. Maratha campaigns into Rajasthan from the 1740s put severe pressure on these principalities and checked their further expansion. Raja Jai Singh of Jaipur. A description of Raja Jai Singh in a Persian account of 1732. Raja Jai Singh was at the height of his power. He was the governor of Agra for 12 years and a term, and of Malwa for 5 or 6 years. He possessed a large army, artillery and great wealth. His sway extended from Delhi to the banks of the Narmada. Many Rajput chieftains built a number of forts on hills top, which became centers of power with extensive fortification. These majestic structures, household urban centers, palaces, temples, trading centers, water harvesting structure and other buildings. The Chitgarh fort contained many water bodies varying from talabs, ponds to kundis, wells, valleys, step wells, etc. Take a look at figure 4c, Jantar Mantar in Jaipur. Savai Jai Singh, the ruler of Amber, constructed 5 astronomical observatories, one each in Delhi, Jaipur, Ujjaini, Mathura and Varanasi, commonly known as Jantar Mantar. These observatories have various instruments to study heavenly bodies. Take a look at figure 5, Mehragarh Fort, Jodhpur. What is the Kalsa do you recall reading about it in chapter 8? Take a look at figure 7, Fort of Maharaja Ranjit Singh. Seizing independence, the Sikhs, the organization of the Sikhs into a political community during the 17th century, see chapter 8, helped in regional state building in the Punjab. Several battles were fought by Guru Gobind Singh against the Rajput and Mughal rulers, both before and after the institutions of the Khalsa in 1699. After his death in 1708, the Khalsa rose in revolt against the Mughal authority under Banda Bahadur's leadership, declared their sovereignty rule by striking coins in the name of Guru Nanak and Guru Gobind Singh, and established their own administration between the Satluj and the Jamuna. Banda Bahadur was captured in 1750 and executed in 1716. Under a number of able leaders in the 18th century, the Sikhs organized themselves into a number of bands called Jathas, and later on missiles. Their combined forces were known as the Grand Army Dal Khalsa. The entire body used to meet at Amritsar at the time of Baisakhi and Diwali to take collective decisions known as the resolution of the Guru Matas. A system called Rakhi was introduced, offering protection to cultivators on the payment of a tax of 20% of the produce. Take a look at figure 7a, Portrait of Shivaji. Towards the end of the 17th century, a powerful state started emerging in the Deccan under the leadership of Shivaji, which finally led to the establishment of the Maratha state. Shivaji was born to Shahji and Jija Bhai at Shivneri in 1630. Under the guidance of his mother and his guardian Dada Kondev, Shivaji embarked on a career of conquest at a young age. The occupation of Javali made him the undisputed leader of the Mawala highlands, which paved the way for further expansion. His exploits against the forces of Bijapur and the Mughals made him a legendary figure. He often resorted to guerrilla warfare against his opponents by introducing an efficient administrative system supported by a revenue collection method based on chalk and Sardeshmukhi. He laid the foundations of a strong Maratha state. Guru Gobind Singh had inspired the Khalsa with the belief that their dynasty was to rule Raj Karega Khalsa. Their well-knit organization enabled them to put up a successful resistance to the Mughal governors first, and then to Ahmad Shah Abdali, who had seized the rich province of the Punjab and the Sarkar of Sirhind from the Mughals. The Khalsa declared their sovereignty rule by striking their own coin again in 1765. Significantly, this coin bore the same inscription as the one on the orders issued by the Khalsa in the time of Banda Bahadur. The Sikh territories in the late 18th century extended from the Indus to the Jamuna, but they were divided under different rulers. One of them, Maharaja, his capital at Lahore in 1799. The Marthas. The Martha kingdom was another powerful regional kingdom to arise out of a sustained opposition to Mughal rule. Shivaji, 1627-1680, carved out a stable kingdom with the support of powerful families, Deshmukh's groups of highly mobile peasant pastoralists. Kanbis provided the backbone of the Martha army. Shivaji used these forces to challenge the Mughal in the peninsula. After Shivaji's death, effective power in the Martha state was wielded by a family of Chitpavan Brahmanas who served Shivaji's successors as Pashwa or principal minister. Pune became the capital of the Martha Kingdom. Under the Peshwas, the Marthas developed a very successful military organization. Their success lay in bypassing the fortified areas of the Mughals by raiding cities and by engaging Mughal armies in areas where their supply lines and reinforcements could be easily distributed. Between 1720 and 1761, the Martha Empire expanded. It gradually chipped away at the authority of the Mughal Empire. Malwa and Gujarat were seized from the Mughals by the 1720s. By the 1730s, the Martha King was recognized as the overlord of the entire Deccan Peninsula. He possessed the right to levy Chauhan and Sardeshmukhi in the entire region. After raiding Delhi in 1737, the frontiers of Martha domination expanded rapidly into Rajasthan and the Punjab in the north, into Bengal and Odisha in the east, and into Karnataka and the Tamil and Telugu countries in the south. See map 1. They were not formally included in the Martha Empire but were made to pay tribute as a way of accepting Martha sovereignty. Expansion brought enormous resources, but it came at a price. These military campaigns also made other rulers hostile towards the Marthas. As a result, why were not inclined to support the Marthas during the Third Battle of Panipat in 1761? Bajirao I, also known as Bajirao Bhalal, was the son of Peshwa Balaji Vishwanath. He was a great Martha general who is credited to have expanded the Martha kingdom beyond the Vindhyas and is known for his military campaigns against Malwa, Bundelkhand, Gujarat and the Portuguese. Chow, 25% of the land revenue claimed by Jamindars in the Deccan, this was collected by the Marathas. Sir Deshmukhi, 9-10% of the land revenue paid to the head revenue collector in the Deccan. Alongside endless military campaigns, the Marthas developed an effective administrative system as well. Once conquest had been completed and Martha rule was secure, revenue demands were gradually introduced, taking local conditions into account. Agriculture was encouraged and trade revived. This allowed Martha chiefs, Sardars like Sindhia of Gwalior, Gaikwad of Baroda and Bonsle of Nagpur, the resources to raise powerful armies. Martha campaigns into Malwa in the 1720s did not challenge the growth and prosperity of the cities in the region. Ujjaini expanded under Sindhi's patronage and Indore under Halkars. By all accounts, these cities were large and prosperous and functioned as important commercial and cultural centers. New trade routes emerged within the areas controlled by the Marathas. The silk producer in the Chanderi region now found a new outlet in Pune. The Maratha capital, Burhanpur, which had earlier participated in the trade between Agra and Surat, now expanded its hinterland to include Pune and Nagpur in the south and Lucknow and Allahabad in the east. The Jats. Like the other states, the Jats consolidated their power during the late 17th and 18th centuries under their leader Chaudhaman. They acquired control over territories situated to the west of the city of Delhi, and by the 1680s they had begun dominating a region between the two imperial cities of Delhi and Agra. For a while they became the virtual custodians of the city of Agra. The power of the Jats reached its zenith under Suraj Mal, who consolidated the Jat state at Bharatpur in present-day Rajasthan during 1756 to 1763. The areas under the political control of Suraj Mal broadly included parts of modern eastern Rajasthan, southern Haryana, western Uttar Pradesh and Delhi. Suraj Mal built a number of forts and palaces at the famous Lohagarh Fort in Bharatpur is regarded as one of the strongest forts built in this region. Look at figure 8. 18th century palace complex at Nodhi Bangla Dome on the assembly hall on the roof of the building. The Jats were prosperous agriculturists, and towns like Panipat and Belbhagar become important trading centers in the areas dominated by them. Under Suraj Mal, the kingdom of Bharatpur emerged as a strong state. When Nadir Shah sacked Delhi in 1739, many of the city's notables took refuge there. His son Jawahar Shah had 30,000 troops of his own and had another 20,000 Marathas and 15,006 troops to fight the Mughals. While the Bharatpur fort was built in a fairy traditional style at Digdi, Jats built an elaborate garden palace combining styles seen at Amber and Agra. Its buildings were modeled and architectural forms first associated with royalty under Shah Jahan. See figure 12 in chapter 5 and figure 12 in chapter 9. Elsewhere, the French Revolution, 1789 to 1794. In the various state systems of 18th century India, the common people did not enjoy the right to participate in the affairs of their governments. In the Western wars, this was the situation until the late 18th century. The American 1776 to 1781 and French Revolution challenged the social and political privileges enjoyed by the aristocrats. During the French Revolution, the middle classes, peasants and artisans fought against the special rights enjoyed by the clergy and the nobility. They believed that no group in society should have depend on merit. The philosophers of the French Revolution suggested that there be equal laws and opportunities for all. They also held that the authority of the government should come from the people, who must possess the right to participate in its affairs. Movements such as the French and American revolutions gradually transformed subjects into citizens. The ideas of citizenship, nation state and democratic rights took root in India from the late 19th century. Imagine you are a ruler of an 18th century kingdom. Tell us about the steps you would take to make your position strong in your province and what position or problems you might face while doing so. Let's recall. Question number 1. Match the following. Subhadar, Fauzdar, Ijardar, Misil, Chauhat, Kanbis, Umara. A revenue farmer, a high noble provincial governor, Maratha peasant warriors, a Mughal military commander, a band of Sikh warriors, tax levied by the Marathas. Keywords. Subhadari, डाल कलसा मिसल फौजुदार इजारधारी चौहत सर देशमुखी। क्वेश्चन नंबर टू, फिल इन द ब्लैंक्स। औरंगजेब फोर्ट प्रोट्रैक्टेड वॉर इन द डैश बी उमर एंड जागीरदार कंस्टिट्यूटेड पावरफुल सेक्शंस ऑफ द मुगल डैश सी आसफ जाह फाउंडेड द हैदराबाद स्टेट इन डैश डी द फाउंडर ऑफ द अवध स्टेट वॉज डैश। क्वेश्चन नंबर थ्री, स्टेट वेदर ट्रू और फॉल्स। नादिर शाह इन्वॉल्वड बंगाल बी सवाई राजा जय सिंह वॉज द रूलर ऑफ इंडोर सी गुरु गोविंद सिंह वॉज द 10th गुरु ऑफ द सिक्स डी पूना बिकम द कैपिटल ऑफ द मार्थास इन द 18th सेंचुरी। क्वेश्चन नंबर फोर, वॉट वर द ऑफिशियल्स हेल्ड बाई सादत खान। लेट्स डिस्कस। क्वेश्चन नंबर फाइव, वाई डिड द नवाब्स ऑफ अवध एंड बंगाल ट्राई टू डू अवे विद द जागीरदारी सिस्टम। क्वेश्चन नंबर सिक्स, हाउ वर द सिक्स ऑर्गेनाइज्ड इन द 18th सेंचुरी। क्वेश्चन नंबर सेवन, वाई डिड द मार्थास वॉन्ट टू एक्सपैंड बियॉन्ड द डेक्कन। क्वेश्चन नंबर एट, वॉट वर द पॉलिटिक्स पॉलिसीज अडोप्टेड बाई आसफ जाह टू स्ट्रेंथन हिज पोजिशंस। क्वेश्चन नंबर नाइन, डू यू थिंक मर्चेंट्स एंड बैंकर्स टूडे हैव द काइंड ऑफ इन्फ्लुएंस दे हैड इन द 18th सेंचुरी। क्वेश्चन नंबर टेन, डिड एनी ऑफ द किंगडम्स मेंशन इन दिस चैप्टर डेवलप इन यूर स्टेट, इफ सो इन वॉट वेज डू यू थिंक life in the state would have been different in the 18th century from what it is in the 21st century. Let's do question number 11. Find out more about the architecture and culture associated with the new courts of any of the following above, Bengal or Hyderabad. Question number 12. Collect popular tales about rulers from any one of the following groups of people, the Rajputs, Jats, Sikhs or Marthas. Thank you.